So our clinic now has about 7,000 patients across three different sites in central London, and we are growing by about 20 to 25 new patients a week, some of which are coming from sub-Saharan African migration, some of which are heterosexual transmission, and the majority of which are young gay men becoming infected within central London. We're also seeing a lot of hepatitis C sexually transmitted amongst gay men in London, so a phenomenon that I think you're seeing here on a background of so-called sero sorting. And because, of course, people with undetectable HIV RNA tend not to transmit HIV, we're seeing some mono-infected with hepatitis C amongst our gay population as well, because they're having sex with somebody who's HIV positive on treatment but with hep C, and not getting HIV but getting hep C. So we're getting a whole range of things. And of course, with the hep C patients, some of them take 6 months or thereabouts to develop antibodies, and so we are screening people who've had recent sexually transmitted infection with hep C RNAs rather than with antibodies to try and pick people up earlier so that we can treat them relatively cost-effectively, because of course they tend to respond better when they're treated during seroconversion, and that some of our seroconverters have normal liver function, so it's not good enough just to look at their LFTs and say, are they okay from that standpoint, but can we do better? So that's our practice. We have an inpatients, outpatients, we have a pharmacokinetic unit where we do early phase research, drug development studies, drug-drug interaction work, and other intensive studies. We do a lot of work, as I'll mention, about forgiveness of treatment regimens, etc. So when I'm talking to somebody with treatment, I tend to think about, you know, the idea of Maslow's hierarchy of needs in psychology, where you say, if you don't have food and water, you can't do anything, which is why historically you used to get free food and water at these meetings, otherwise you wouldn't concentrate. And then you move on to pursue shelter, and then you look for comfort and love, and eventually you reach a point of self-attainment where you're happy and cheery and nothing can stop you now. And so I think in terms of antiretroviral treatment, I have my hierarchy of needs, but my patients have a different hierarchy of needs to what I want to offer them. So people don't say to me ever, I want to have an effective treatment for my HIV, because they think, you're not going to offer me a treatment that's ineffective, so I don't need to ask that question. So the negotiation with the patient is much more about, can I have this medication and have a normal life? And the starting point for that is, how is this medication going to intrude into my well-being? How is it going to make me feel different to the way I feel now? Is it going to affect other things that I might be taking? People are very interested in, is it going to affect their physical appearance, but also is it going to affect their cognitive performance in that regard? People are obviously interested in, they don't want their friends necessarily to know about their status, so they don't want to have to change aspects of what they're doing in their day-to-day life. So can they still have recreational drugs? Can they still drink alcohol normally? And can they still conceive and have a family in the future? Then, are the drugs that you give me for the HIV going to store up other problems for the future? And I think there's this big phenomenon that people take medication and they want to blame everything bad that goes on in their life on the medication that they take rather than anything else. And I think all too often as physicians, we join in that game and say, I'm going to change your treatment around because of something you just told me, whereas I'm not, rather than searching for the root cause of that phenomenon. I've had a few people who have been, say, taking efavirenz for 5 years, doing perfectly well, and then they come in and say, I've started hallucinating and having bad dreams again. And so I've learned that the next question is, when did you start using meth, rather than saying, you know, let's change you off the A-tripler. And, you know, it's great the way people are quite happy to, you know, blame the prescribed medication rather than blame the non-prescribed medication. So ultimately, I think this idea of intrusion is a very interesting part of understanding the customer experience with a medication. Does the medication place demands on somebody's life where it's controlling them rather than just controlling the virus through dose timing accuracy through the number of pills that they have to open and hide away from other people, from the food and fluid requirements that may exist, from the drug-drug interactions that may exist, from the adverse experiences. So one has to balance all of those things out. From the physician's standpoint, I tend to have a different hierarchy of needs, that my first point is that I can't treat somebody for 50 years unless I'm going to give them the appropriate efficacy, because my objective now is that I want to hand over my cohort of about 1,000 people that I look after myself over to somebody in 10 years, 15 years time in perfect working order. And of course, actually that enhances my quality of life, because if everyone's in perfect working order, I leave work at 5 o'clock in the afternoon and don't have any worries on my mind about what's going to happen overnight or in the coming weeks, and that nobody's going to bounce back to me. So getting the efficacy part of things is important. Counselling people about the experience of what's going to happen when you start on the medication. The first month's likely to be the worst month as you get used to what's going on. And of course, in the first month, you have that additional psychological overlay of anxiety. Am I going to do something wrong with the drugs? Are the drugs going to cause me something? I'm going to read through this horrendous package insert, which will tell me that I'll get all of these things wrong with me, nearly all of which happened in the placebo arm as well. So there's that aspect. Of course, people are interested in, are the drugs going to have an effect on their long-term health? Is it going to contribute to comorbidities, or is it going to reduce comorbidities? And of course, while people, for example, have focused a little bit on, say, diabetes or on heart disease or bone disease, kidney disease, neurocognitive disorder, largely actually when we look at the frequency of those events, the incidence, is that they're actually declining in cohorts of people with HIV, because treating HIV better reduces most of those events rather than upregulates them. So whilst there's been a tendency to say, are the drugs contributing to these events, actually treating HIV has a much bigger impact on the frequency of those events than not treating HIV, and that's always a very clear balance when we talk to people about the impact of drugs on comorbidities, is that not treating your HIV well is the first thing that's going to impact those comorbidities to the greater degree. So here I am, 5 hours different from my normal time. So I took my atorvastatin last night as I went to bed, 5 hours later than I normally did. It doesn't matter, because even if I missed my dose of atorvastatin, I don't like to miss it simply because I like to take my pill as reliably as I encourage my patients to take their pills. So it's a test on me as can I do what I'm asking them to do, is that I'm not going to have statin-resistant hypercholesterolemia as a result of taking my atorvastatin at the wrong time. But I want to think about having a PK profile with my drugs that is going to be relevant, so that people say, my life is not dominated by 8 o'clock in the morning I take a pill, or 11 o'clock at night I take a pill, because sometimes I want to go out later than 11 o'clock at night. Not me very often anymore, but sometimes. Sometimes I want to sleep in later than 8 o'clock in the morning, a lot of the time. I want to have something that is going to fit in with my change in day-to-day activities rather than dominate my life. So as ever, I'll be hoping that I'll know one of my airline stewards when I get on the plane this evening, because he might upgrade me, might give me a nice bottle of champagne to take off the plane, that sort of thing. But I'll also know that he'll be in 5 hours behind the UK time last night when he slept, and in 5 days' time he might be in Singapore and being 9 hours ahead of UK time. And if he's taking medication, he needs to have something that he can adjust through those different time zones without needing to worry about that. So if we take a tripler as an example, when we did the study that we published about a year and a half ago with a tripler, we gave healthy volunteers a tripler for 14 days. Healthy volunteers, I can assure you, have to get paid to take a tripler, because they don't enjoy it, because your 14 days is your worst 14 days on a tripler. So we have to pay people quite generously to take a tripler for 14 days. And at the end of that 14 days, we stopped and said, how long does it take for the drugs to disappear? So this is one of our typical forgiveness studies. So if you were 72 hours on from your last dose, in other words, you were 2 days late, everyone still had therapeutic exposures of efavirenz above 1,000 nanograms per mil. and everyone had measurable levels of tenofovir diphosphate and FTC triphosphate in their PBMCs at that time point. We don't have a therapeutic target for intracellular di and triphosphate levels. So we get an idea that even if people are quite chaotic with the timing accuracy of A-tripler, they've actually got lots of forgiveness built into the combination in that regard. The trade-off they make for that is that it might make their lipids a little bit worse and it might affect their sleep quality and diurnal cognitive function. So that's a trade-off that you discuss with people in that regard. When we've looked with the PIs, Kaletra, for example, very poor forgiveness. Some people actually are below therapeutic target at the end of the 24-hour dosing interval. If you go to 6 hours late with lopinavir, more than half of the people are below the therapeutic target. Whereas when we looked with atazanavir and darunavir, most people, well, 100% of people with atazanavir and close to 100% of people with darunavir still have therapeutic exposure of drug 6 hours after their last dose was due. So you can say you can be a few hours either way with those drugs without really needing to worry. So if you're on atazanavir and you were going to have a holiday in London, you wouldn't have to worry. You'd just take your medication with your breakfast in the same way that you normally would do. With raltegravir, we know from the QD Merck study that that's a twice-a-day drug, not a once-a-day drug for initial therapy. So we always have to advise people you want to take two intakes in a day with that drug rather than one intake. And we're planning to do some further studies with the other integrase inhibitors, just going through contracting and so forth at the present time. So watch out for those types of further studies from Moyle and Buffito in the coming year.
Can I just ask, in terms of the other integrase inhibitors, how do you cancel patients around forgiveness for them right now in the absence of data?
Yeah, so we know that with both elvitegravir and dolutegravir is that when they were doing their original dose ranging studies, that they saw quite high levels of activity at the top, at several of the top doses that they looked at. So effectively they're overdosed, for want of a better purpose, to give them a PK cushion at the end of the 24 hours that is not going to be a Favarin's-like, because the half-life of the drug isn't as long for either of them, but is going to give them some level of flexibility, but certainly for 6+ hours either way. So that's our anticipated effect. Obviously, it's a bit difficult with cobicistat, because the cobicistat disappears over the course of 24 hours. And so if we take lopinavir, ritonavir as an example, in the first 12 hours with lopinavir, ritonavir, you had slope A, relatively slow decline in lopinavir levels. After 12 hours, the ritonavir had largely disappeared, and you had then slope B, a more rapid decline in lopinavir levels. And after 24 hours, you absolutely didn't have any effect of the ritonavir, and you had slope C, an even more rapid decline. So we did some statistical testing on it, showing that there was a significantly faster decline in lopinavir levels in the second 24 hours than in the first 24 hours. But actually, it's evident after about the 12-hour time point. So for pharmaco-enhanced drugs, their forgiveness is in part influenced by the half-life of the pharmaco-enhanced product and how long that stays around. If you look at the curves with cobicistat, elvitegravir out at 24 hours, they still have a long, slow half-life at that time point, with a half-life of around 10 hours or thereabouts. The half-life of dolutegravir is a little bit longer than that regard. So I suspect the flexibility of dolutegravir is going to be slightly better than the flexibility in that regard. But then you reach a point. A few years ago, we were trying to do some work with a nucleoside drug called apricitabine, which had a half-life of, I think it was a week. And it was very difficult to do early phase development of the drug, because if you tried giving the drug to a infected individual for 7 days, as you would normally do with 7 days monotherapy, you then had a tail of drug where you'd have exposure going out for 2 or 3 weeks afterwards, which was going to be selective of resistant virus. So the drug finished up really not getting developed, because sometimes having too long a half-life can become a problem, particularly when in individuals who stop and start their medication. So if we take, for example, in 5142, there was the combination of Caletra plus efavirenz study. And the rates of resistance in that arm of the study were higher for both Caletra and efavirenz, because, of course, if you stop taking your Caletra, your efavirenz or your regimen, the Caletra would disappear and your efavirenz would stay there as monotherapy, resulting in large amounts of non-nucleoside resistance being selected. Whereas when you took efavirenz with Truvada, you'd have the whole regimen present for a period of that time, and therefore the time to rebound would be deeper into the efavirenz tail, resulting in less time spent in a monotherapy selection phase. And of course, the other phenomenon with that combination was that efavirenz reduced Caletra levels, resulting in lower exposure to Caletra, which narrows its genetic barrier to resistance, resulting in some resistance being observed. So pharmacokinetics can be a good thing, but too much of a good thing might be problematic. And of course, with people talking about long-acting injectable therapies, etc., in the long term, for all of those products, generally it's believed there'll need to be a run-in of oral therapy to establish steady state and establish tolerability before you start giving a drug that might be taken once a month by injection. Because, of course, if you don't tolerate it, you have an injection, you've got a month of intolerability to suffer, and so you need to know. So for people who think those are going to be game-changing products, I think we're still a long way off understanding how they'll work, and people will still have to do an oral run-in. So these are the DHHS guidelines as they've just been modified. They really herald, to a certain extent, the age of the integrase inhibitor, because integrase inhibitors have become the most recommended regimens. Four out of the seven main regimens are integrase-based. There's some recommendations for real piverine based on restricted criteria, some recommendations for abacavir 3TC with other products based on restricted criteria of high viral load, low CD4 count. Remembering that there's never been a study of Kyvexa with darunavir, ritonavir, and there's quite limited data of abacavir 3TC with real piverine, both of which are hobbled by high viral load, and therefore that may be an issue in that regard. So we've got lots of selection about integrase resistant products, and so that's going to be, to a certain extent, where I'm going to focus the rest of the talk. So I tried to put on a slide what I go through in my head about regimen selection in terms of what are the things that are going to influence the drugs that I'm going to use in practice. So is this a product that's been stress tested in high viral load, low CD4 count individuals, late presenters? We see quite a lot of late presenters, because particularly amongst heterosexual patients and recent migrants to the UK, they tend to wait for their migration status to be stable. They tend to have other priorities other than their health before they present, so they're often presenting late. Older individuals tend to present later because they don't reflect on the idea that they're at risk. Female subjects tend to present later, which may be one of the reasons why they've been somewhat underrepresented in many of the recent clinical trials. And then, of course, we have people who present with TB, with hepatitis C, with a malignancy, where our choice of drugs is going to be influenced by the immediate need to avoid drug-drug interactions rather than what we might necessarily plan to give them for a long term. So, for example, all our malignancy and TB and hep C patients get raltegravir to start off with, and then once they've completed their treatment, they then roll over to something that is more convenient for them to take but may not have been suitable for a drug-drug interaction standpoint to be what we give them in those circumstances. And obviously we try and get a history around who did they likely acquire from, who was their donor of HIV, and are they likely to have had transmitted resistance. We don't see a lot of transmitted resistance within our cohort. We don't routinely screen integrase at the present time, largely because of, in the UK, there have been so few failures on integrase-based regimens that we don't believe we have a prevalent risk available. Clearly, if somebody reports transmission occurring outside of the UK in a country where there may be a little bit more resistance, such as the United States, where, of course, people are forever going on and off treatment because they drop in and out of insurance, etc., or France, where there's a relatively higher rate of treatment failure, then we will do more extensive resistance testing. But it's not cost-effective, and at the present time, a lot of our decisions are in part influenced by the cost effectiveness of treatment or the total cost, rather than simply just focusing on one aspect of that. Then I'm going to think about safety. I'm going to think about what comorbidities this person has. So when somebody is 50, I'm going to be offering them a statin. That's my birthday present to people when they see me, is as you turn 50, you get a statin from Dr. Moyle. You also get a bone mineral density scan as well. So it's a couple of nice gifts I find for them.
Any birthday cake?
I'm afraid not. And it's really hard to stick a candle into a Lipitor tablet, I can tell you. So I'm going to think about, the treatment that might be right for a 20-year-old may not be the same treatment that's right for a 40-year-old or a 50-year-old. If the 20-year-old's using a whole lot of recreational drugs, the treatment for him might be different to the 30-year-old who's grown out of that phase of their life. And then I'm also going to pay a little bit of attention to their genetic history. Obviously, HLA-B5701, there's some argument about whether sulfur drug allergies should result in caution about the use of darunavir because it has a sulfur moiety, and there was some sulfur reaction in people, particularly with fosamprenavir, which is the father product of darunavir. Just recently, there was a paper from Heather Ribardo at the ACTG looking at subjects in the 5202 study and whether they had Gilbert syndrome genetically at baseline, showing that specifically if you were Hispanic and had Gilbert syndrome, you had a high likelihood of developing a grade 3 or 4 hyperbilirubinemia on study and discontinuing atazanavir. And broadly what I do is I don't give atazanavir to people who have got high bilirubins at baseline. So if your bilirubin's 15 or 14, I'm going to say you're likely to have Gilbert syndrome even if I haven't fasted you. And therefore, if you start at 15 and atazanavir, let's say, trebles your bilirubin, you're likely to finish up at 60 and have a chance of being yellow. Therefore, I don't want to take that risk. Whereas if your bilirubin's 5 and I treble it, it's going to be 20 and you're not going to be any concern. In the same way that if I had somebody whose cholesterol was, you use millimoles per liter in Canada, don't you? So if your cholesterol's 4.9 at baseline, chances are it's going to be 5.5 when you go on to a tripler. And therefore, I know that you're going to go into a grade of hypercholesterolemia when I treat you with that drug. Therefore, I'm going to think about giving a different product that may have a more benign lipid profile, whereas if you present with a cholesterol of 3 and your HDL's a bit low as well, then maybe a triple is going to be quite good because it's good at increasing HDL as well as total cholesterol. So there's going to be some flexibility about looking at the baseline biochemistry that will reflect an individual's baseline genetics and making different choices about saying, I'd rather not give this drug. So an example of one of my patients recently was a young woman from France, a lawyer. She'd been diagnosed after recent acquisition of HIV. She'd had a negative test about 6 months earlier. Unknown source donor, and had been started on darunavir, ritonavir, Truvada by a French physician, and came to see me because she was working in London with bloating, with 3 loose stools a day. She'd gained a little bit of weight predominantly in her abdomen, and 25-year-old French girls are even more obsessed than 17-year-old English girls with such things. I have a 17-year-old daughter, so I'm constantly watching what she eats. And so we changed. So I looked at her characteristics. So she was doing a high-intensity job that did often quite long hours. So she said, a tripler is not the right product for me. I eat with colleagues and I eat with clients on a regular basis, so I don't want something that's food dependent. So that ruled out Complera. Her bilirubin was 15, so I said, I'm not going to give you atazanavir because chances are you'll go yellow and it's probably not going to take the ritonavir out of your regimen. So I gave her Stribild. 4 weeks later, her viral load's undetectable. She's feeling dramatically better. Her waist circumference has gone down, so her clothes are fitting more comfortably. Her bloating's gone away. Now, if she was in a clinical trial, she wouldn't have been classified as having any grade of diarrhea because she was going 3 times a day, which is within the normal range. And bloating isn't an adverse event within a clinical trial. So you don't have a grade for, can I have grade 1, 2, or 3 bloating? I don't know, how are you going to grade it? I never quite understand how they grade dreams in clinical trials. So she wouldn't have been actually picked up as an adverse event in a clinical trial, but she had something that was impacting her lifestyle meaningfully that was resolved by modifying her treatment and that the right choice was to look through what are all these classifications of things that I'm going to think about so that I individualize the choice of that drug to make sure that the experience is likely to be the best experience for that individual. And in her case, it was a Stribild choice. And then, of course, a lot of people are interested in pill burden and the intrusiveness of their regimen. So in the past, we've been looking at switching people away from a triplet to try and manage CNS side effects. Laura Waters published a paper that she did when she was at our site where we switched people over to a Travarine once daily. But that was going from one pill to five pills once a day, and of course a Travarine pills are slightly disgusting to take. And so it wasn't a very good trade-off, and a lot of people said, that's too many pills, I don't want to make that trade. Then we did it with raltegravir, same sort of phenomenon, the CNS side effects go away, but a lot of people said, no, I don't want to trade one pill for twice daily dosing, and therefore that's not acceptable for me. So what we're seeing now with a lot more people coming forward and switching over to other single tablet regimens that are alternatives to efavirenz, is that we're recognising what you might see as a below the tip of the iceberg phenomenon. There's a bunch of people who say, I get CNS side effects with efavirenz, they bother me, they intrude into my sleep and my diurnal well-being. But then there's a whole bunch of other people that don't really report CNS side effects, but when you take them off efavirenz, suddenly say, hey, this is a new normal to the normal I thought that I was experiencing before. I've actually been living in a cloud of haziness for the last X number of years on efavirenz, and you've taken that away, and I realized that I wasn't feeling normal before. I'm feeling much more normal now on this new product. And often the hint you get from that is when people say, oh, I took my efavirenz one night, and then the phone rang, and I had to stay awake and talk to somebody, and gosh, I felt lousy when I did that, or I forgot to take my pill last night, so I took it in the morning, and then I felt crap all day. There's a lot of people where they say they're tolerating the product very well, but actually there's an underlying phenomenon that doesn't necessarily meet their cognizance regularly, but is real when you actually remove the product. And the other thing I put on the list here is over-the-counter remedies, because clearly there's quite an issue about many over-the-counter remedies. We've seen data with magnesium, calcium, and aluminium preparations that they impact dolutegravir, raltegravir, and almost certainly elvitegravir. The European label for dolutegravir says you even have to separate it from multivitamin and mineral tablets because the minerals in the vitamin pills will chelate the drug in the gut and reduce the absorption by 50%. So if you're on a vitamin pill even, you have to say if you're on Tivicay, separate this by 2 hours, take it at least 2 hours after you've taken your Tivicay to avoid what is a 50% reduction in exposure. And so, of course, there's a lot of over-the-counter remedies that people may use where there may be unexpected interactions. And this chelation phenomenon we've described with atazanavir and zinc, where it chelates both the bilirubin and the atazanavir, bringing down the levels of both. So I use it handily to manage hyperbilirubinemia in the short term. But obviously, hyperbilirubinemia is for people who have got very high atazanavir levels, so it doesn't matter if their levels come down. But clearly, if you've got low atazanavir levels and you take zinc because you've got a cold or that sort of thing, and many of the over-counter preparations for cold remedies have zinc in them now, you may be finding that your levels of atazanavir fall to low levels. So a lot of the divalent cations, iron, calcium, zinc, selenium, magnesium, aluminium are all likely to chelate drugs in the gut, and we have to be careful about reminding people that those are commonly present in over-the-counter preparations and that we need to separate them from a wide variety of things, in the same way they've got used to people not taking St. John's wort and garlic supplements and those other kinds of things. But the more we do PK studies, the more we find these interactions. So let's look at efficacy. So what's a little sad is that the ACTG have said, we're not going to do studies comparing regimen A with regimen B with regimen C anymore. We're going to focus on strategy, on vaccine, and on cure-related research. So studies like START for strategy rather than studies that are going to compare regimen A with regimen B. So I think in the future, for example, we're never going to have a comparative study of Stribild versus the Vive tablet of abacavir 3TC and dolutegravir, because why would either company do the study? because there's a chance that they could lose. Because you would imagine that if you look at the confidence intervals around an outcome, probably you've got 20% on either side of those confidence intervals where one might be better than the other by chance within a randomized study rather than by actuality. So why would either company take the risk of doing it? So we're never going to have the complete answer to, of the best regimens that we've got at the present time, than the simplest regimens that we've got at the present time, are we going to compare these? This is an interesting study, but it's an open label study, and there's one particular caution that hasn't been particularly predominant about that, and that is that our dear friends at Abbott didn't provide the ritonavir to the AIDS clinical trials group. So if you were randomized to one of the once daily PI arms, you had to go out and source your own ritonavir within the study. So it was a little obstacle for those individuals and may have been a reason why some individuals switched within the regimen to try and take away that inconvenience. It's unclear how much that was an effect. And of course, if you chose not to, or if you've forgotten to fill your ritonavir script, if you take darunavir, particularly without ritonavir, you get not very much darunavir. If you take atazanavir without ritonavir, you get a reasonable amount of atazanavir. So it may have been an additional bias against darunavir within the study. So what our payers have done is look at this slide and they say, so for people who can't take a tripler, whichever of the three things you're randomized to, you finish up in the same place at the end of 96 weeks. All of the three regimens were equivalent to each other according to the statistical plan of the ACTG. Therefore, let's start with the cheapest and we'll go to the next cheapest and we'll go to the next cheapest. And so it then becomes a race to the bottom on price, rather than thinking about what's the impact of for people on intrusiveness and on tolerability and on tablet burden. The other phenomenon that is strange within the study and was pre-planned by the ACTG is that if you fell within the 10% boundary here, you were counted as equivalent. So even if the lower bound suggested you were inferior, you were still called equivalent. So darunavir versus raltegravir is both darunavir is equivalent to raltegravir and is also inferior to raltegravir. But they never did the inferiority test because it was only planned to do inferiority tests if non-equivalence was demonstrated. So I don't know how you can be inferior and equivalent at the same time. That may be a way I might classify lovers in the future. But not treatments. And then, of course, the argument that will be perpetually relevant to protease inhibitors is that they're associated with a lower risk of option loss at the time of failure. So there was very little resistance emergence in the darunavir group relative to the atazanavir group. You can see numerically the number of people who reached a failure endpoint, 84 in raltegravir, 94 with atazanavir, and 115 with darunavir. So darunavir was the least good performing regimen from a virological standpoint, even though it's been promoted on this potency strapline for a long period of time. Actually, in terms of virological control, it did least well. But for both the PI arms, there were vanishingly few resistance. Only 3% of people in the raltegravir arm developed any resistance, of which some of it included integrase resistance emergence. Now, just to comment on that, if you look at the SPRING 2 study that compared dolutegravir with raltegravir, there was only 2 out of 414 people randomized to raltegravir who developed raltegravir resistance in that study, which reflects the fact that in those Glaxo studies, they were doing resistance testing on the first failure sample rather than the confirmatory failure sample, and therefore they picked up a much lower rate of raltegravir resistance and also reported no dolutegravir resistance in those samples. In the sailing study, which was a treatment-experienced integrase-naive study with dolutegravir, they did see some dolutegravir resistance at failure, and it was a single mutation that is characteristically seen in vitro sequencing. So I think we have to look at the methodology that people use in clinical studies, often to avoid problems or under-report problems. So this is single. This looked at abacavir 3TC dolutegravir against Truvada efavirenz, so it's a regimen comparison study and was blinded. And the outcome favoured dolutegravir statistically significantly. So it was one of two studies that had been a little bit better than efavirenz in recent times. So in doing the study, what we had to do was that at baseline, week 2, 4, 8, 12, patients were administered a page-plus long questionnaire about, did you sleep well last night? Did you have dreams? Did you feel sluggish in the morning? Did you have a hangover? Did you feel dizzy? So people were primed by all these questions about central nervous system side effects. The discontinuation rate for efavirenz in this study for CNS side effects was 10%. In Startmark, which didn't have those questionnaires, was 5%. So efavirenz isn't twice as less well tolerated now than it was 4 years ago. It's simply that by manipulating the study by putting particular questionnaires or endpoints in it, they were able to change what is normally a perverse experience into an adverse experience with efavirenz. And even in a blinded study, people would then drop out. And as I'll show in a moment, dolutegravir was associated with a higher rate of insomnia than efavirenz within the study, almost certainly because people were lying in bed at night before their clinic visit thinking, I've got that bloody questionnaire to fill out tomorrow morning. What am I going to say about my sleep patterns? And as a result, not sleeping as they worried about that. In spring, no funny questionnaires, both products incredibly well tolerated. As we see with the integrase class, one of the reasons why the age of the integrase is arriving in guidelines and in practice is because we're seeing products that have amazingly low rates of treatment discontinuation for adverse experience during the course of studies. And with Flamingo, we again had the phenomenon of dolutegravir doing better than the PI, rather similarly to the way raltegravir did better than the PIs in 5257, largely driven by better tolerability in high viral load subjects, and I'll show that in a moment. In the Stribild studies, again, we saw just squeaking in to being superior to efavirenz at week 48, but also according to the 10% non-inferiority guidelines, also non-inferior as well as a little bit better. Relative to atazanavir, the trends consistently favoured Stribild numerically, but the products were very, very similar in their performance over multiple weeks of follow-up. And of course, in Startmark, similar to efavirenz for the first couple of years, and then a little bit better as people continued to discontinue efavirenz over 5 years of follow-up. And of course, in 5202, if you were given a bacavir, you did less well whether you were given efavirenz or atazanavir, but consistently, atazanavir and efavirenz performed very similarly to each other within that study. So I think when we think about our regimen effectiveness, we need to think, has the regimen been stress tested in high viral load, low CD4 count? Because where did, say, Kaletra underperform efavirenz in 5142, or Artemis or Castle was high viral load, low CD4 count? Where did QD Merck show that raltegravir wasn't a once-a-day product was in high viral load, low CD4 count patients? So it's important to test that. So there's Castle. Atazanavir was the same in high viral load, low CD4 count patients. Kaletra saw a drop-off in efficacy, predominantly driven by more discontinuations. With Artemis, we can see there's a little drop-off at high viral load with the darunavir group, but the drop-off is much greater with the Kaletra group, predominantly driven, again, by more GI-related discontinuations. We see the same phenomenon regarding CD4. So the NEAT 1 study was the first study from what is trying to be the European AIDS Clinical Trials Group equivalent. And this was a nuke-sparing versus a nuke-containing study. So it was darunavir for everyone with either Truvada or raltegravir. And what they observed in this phenomenon in this study was that overall the two groups performed similarly for their efficacy outcome, and that was driven because most of the patients in the study were low viral load subjects and the two regimens performed very similarly. But when we go to high viral load and low CD4 count subjects, there's a big change in the efficacy. And what we see, interestingly, is when you look at Truvada darunavir, it goes from very few failures to quite a lot. When you go from high CD4 count and low CD4 count, you see a big move in the darunavir Truvada efficacy. But when you look at the darunavir raltegravir arm, the shift in efficacy is even greater. So here's a study where, again, maybe we're saying darunavir with Truvada is not so great in high viral load, low CD4 count patients, but it's better than what was used as the comparator. And that's consistent with what was seen in Flamingo, whereas again, the performance in high viral load subjects was very, very similar for dolutegravir, 88% and 93%. For the darunavir arm, it dropped off from 87% to 70% in the low viral load to high viral load. So there's some suggestion that from two studies now that darunavir maybe doesn't do as well in high viral load, lower CD4 count subjects. And of course, numerically, it was the arm that had the greatest number of virological failures in the 5257 study. So maybe amongst the protease inhibitors, there's still some questions to be asked. When we look across the performance of dolutegravir at high versus low, we see in Flamingo no impact of dolutegravir there. In Spring, there was about an 8% difference, whereas raltegravir dropped off a little bit more. And again, when you look at QD Merck, raltegravir BD doesn't do quite so well in high viral load as it does in low viral load, but it does much better than once daily raltegravir in high viral load subjects. And again, for single, we see a little drop off in efficacy in both groups of around about 7% with both the favirans and dolutegravir. I quite like these charts because I think it's important to understand that we treat a broad group of people in clinical trials, in clinical practice, that aren't necessarily seen in clinical trials. So it's nice to know that over 40s and under 40s perform similarly to each other, because more than half of my cohort is over the age of 40. About 25, 28% of them are over the age of 50. The problem with some of the recent studies with Stribild and with Tivacay has been that there's been relatively few females in the study. Therefore, the confidence intervals about observations are less good. White and non-white subjects performing similarly, high viral load subjects performing similarly to comparator, lower CD4 counts. Again, these programs have not contained a lot of people with very low CD4 counts, because the screening processes in the study, which involve Monogram Biosciences doing an integrase resistance test, results in long screening periods that result in hard-to-treat patients, late presenters, not really participating in the study. Because if you walk in with 100 T-cells and 100,000 copies, and your doctor says to you, you need to take treatment straight away, would you like to enter this trial that will delay you starting treatment for a month? Then you don't enter the trial, you go on to the treatment. And so we need a little bit more data. And I think what's interesting, you know, pointing to the question that was asked earlier on about forgiveness, is that probably efavirenz and atazanavir-ritonavir are the two most forgiving other combinations that we have that have been compared against Stribild. And if your adherence by pill count was less than 95%, you still did just as well on Stribild, numerically a little bit better than either of those two comparators, suggesting it's got that same level of flexibility, at least in terms of, say, 6 to 12 hours, as what was seen with other products. So then I start thinking about safety. So, of course, the big driver in 5257 was that atazanavir was inferior to raltegravir and to darunavir in terms of tolerability, and darunavir was equivalent and inferior to raltegravir in that regard. And much of this was driven by jaundice-related discontinuation, as well as hyperbilirubinemia with no adverse experience. So in some cases, physicians were saying, I don't like your bilirubin numbers, I'm going to change you off the product to something else. And of course, because it had no consequence to you, because you were counted as a tolerability endpoint but not an efficacy endpoint, and you stayed on your free product from the AIDS clinical trials group, it was easy to switch people around without having consequence of them having to go back and find insurance, because of course the study was done before Obamacare was introduced, the Affordable Care Act. When you look at the gastrointestinal discontinuations, nearly all of them were also in people with grade 3 and grade 4 bilirubins, suggesting the physicians ticked a box for gastrointestinal side effects when they really meant hepatobiliary side effects in that regard. So when you look across the studies with atazanavir and bilirubin, 5257 stands out with a higher rate of discontinuation than other studies, either Bristol-Myers, or by the AIDS Clinical Trials Group or by Gilead in terms of the rates of discontinuation. So it's a bit of an outlier and probably has something to do with the design of the study in terms of being able to stay on study despite switching medication around, which perhaps may be more reflective of clinical practice. Now, in the past, I would have said, I don't care if you're Billy Rubens 100, you stay on treatment, but there were some data at CROI from a Japanese group and from a French case control study that said if your bilirubin is a grade 4 bilirubin, five times the upper end of the normal range, then your chances of developing kidney stones is much higher. But most of the kidney stones develop 2 years or more into treatment. In other words, you start getting crystals and then gradually you build up enough crystals to have a stone. So probably if you're seeing people with bilirubins in the 60s to 100s, you probably need to think, that person either needs to be encouraged to drink a lot more water because they're going to get a stone in the future, or maybe I need to do something in terms of their atazanavir exposure to adjust for that, change them to a different product, reduce the dose of atazanavir, change them to an unboosted dose, albeit that that's off-label. What we see in individuals starting studies is a certain amount of abnormal dreams, not because pills always cause abnormal dreams, but when you start on treatment, you worry, and worry causes you to sleep lightly, and therefore you remember your hypnagogic experiences. So there's me waking up at 4 o'clock this morning, and so my next 2 hours are attempting to get back to sleep and drifting into phase two sleep at best, and having lots of vivid and crazy dreams that were nothing to do with taking ephedrins last night because I only took Shiraz last night. And an excellent one, yes. But were all to do with having light sleep and increased recollection of dreams. There's also some relationship between immune restoration and sleep, which may also be relevant to those observations. And of course, we see no dizziness relative to ephedrins. This is the sort of GI phenomenon that I was talking about with my anecdote, is that even though we think ritonavir and cobicistat structurally quite similar products, the reality is that the rates of diarrhea are quite markedly lower with Stribil than they are with the ritonavir-containing regimen, even though we think of atazanavir as being the best tolerated gastrointestinal product. Nausea also a little bit lower with Stribil than with the ritonavir-containing regimen. And then I think everyone's very familiar with the creatinine phenomenon related to enzyme inhibition. Probably cobicistat increases Truvada exposure, tenofovir exposure, a little bit less than ritonavir, so you get a lesser impact on bone mineral density, particularly in the spine, relative to the ritonavir boosted regimen. And this is the phenomenon that I was talking about in single, that if you look at insomnia, actually you've got 50% more insomnia with dolutegravir than you have with efavirenz, and you wouldn't normally say to somebody starting on dolutegravir, this is going to make you sleepless, but the reality is that 1 in 8 people had sleeplessness after starting on dolutegravir, worried about that questionnaire. And of course, with diarrhea, when you look at all grades of diarrhea, you see quite a lot of background diarrhea. So again, in different studies, there have been different frequencies of adverse events reported with dolutegravir because it's what they've gone looking for within the study to try and strengthen their effect against the comparator. And of course, dolutegravir has a very similar effect on creatinine levels to cobicistat. They're both a little bit greater than what ritonavir has and even greater than what rilpivirine has. In terms of lipids, there was absolutely no difference between atazanavir and darunavir for lipid outcomes in the study, although slightly better HDL increases with atazanavir. Of course, DADS has said atazanavir is okay from a cardiovascular standpoint. We don't have any DADS safety data around darunavir at the present time. And with all of the integrase inhibitors, they appear to be pretty metabolically benign. What we see in the 102-103 integrated analysis is that Stribil, shown in red, lesser impact on total cholesterol than efavirenz, lesser impact on HDL cholesterol than efavirenz, and lesser impact on triglycerides than either efavirenz or atazanavir. So again, showing that the cobicistat boosting is metabolically different to the ritonavir boosting in that regard. So again, if you've got hypertriglyceridemia on a PI-based regimen, switching to Stribil may lead to some improvement in their lipid outcomes. And of course, with the single study, dolutegravir, abacavir, 3TC, dolutegravir is metabolically benign, abacavir causes cholesterol increases, tenofovir causes cholesterol decreases, efavirenz slightly increases cholesterol. So you finish up with what will be the tri-tablet in the future actually being metabolically similar to efavirenz rather than metabolically advantageous as it would be if it contained Truvada. So it's not going to necessarily be the answer to our metabolic prayers. So what about drug-drug interactions? So, of course, Tribuild comes as a single regimen, so it's not to be combined with other products. There'll be, of course, cobicistat as a standalone product as an alternative to ritonavir to use at some point in the future. Dolutegravir is, of course, about 20% CYP3A metabolized, so it will have some interactions with some other products, particularly the non-nucleosides and some of the older protease inhibitors. So if you're looking at, say, somebody who's in a treatment experience setting where they might be on raltegravir at the present time, dolutegravir may not be an ideal substitution because dolutegravir isn't the same as raltegravir from a metabolism standpoint. Now, this is how you make cobicistat from ritonavir and take it just outside the patent for ritonavir. And you think, well, look at those molecules. They're going to be remarkably similar to each other. But the reality is that unlike ritonavir, cobicistat doesn't induce all of these different CYP enzymes, 1A2, 2B6, 2C9, 2C19, and 1UGT1A1. So your interactions with cobicistat are going to be less than your interactions with ritonavir because cobicistat is affecting less enzymes within the cytochrome system, many of which are quite relevant to the to other products. And, of course, the impact on MATE1 is the reason why the creatinine goes up, that is very similar to what's seen with ritonavir. The difference is about 5 points in GFR between one and the other. And, of course, cobicistat has no HIV activity in that regard and has the potential for other co-formulations. So when you look at the cobicistat proposed label in Europe relative to ritonavir, the number of contraindicated drugs is vastly lower than with ritonavir because you've got less impact on multiple other CYP enzymes with cobicistat relative to ritonavir. Many of them are the same, and some of them are quite absurd because, for example, cisapride was taken off the market 8 years ago but still gets listed as a contraindicated product, so it's a bit silly. This is a survey that Marta Buffito and some other colleagues across Europe did with Gilead's assistance that was presented at the pharmacology workshop this year. And they looked at what co-medications are people taking in the clinic and how many of them are likely to interact with Stribil. And the answer was, most of the time, there's no interaction at all. And some of the time, it's just standard monitoring. So, for example, if you're taking ibuprofen, you have to be careful that non-steroidals affect kidney function. Therefore, you do standard clinical monitoring to be appropriate in that circumstance. And then there'll be a small number of drugs where there's an interaction that may result in a contraindication in that regard. And this is a nice little game that Marta created of saying which medication is contraindicated with Stribild. So effectively, she said, what are the medications that come up most commonly in the co-administered list of products in their survey across Europe? Which of those was contraindicated? And the answer was rifampin is the only one on the whole list that was contraindicated. And it's contraindicated with just about every antiretroviral third agent product. So it's not surprising. So most of the time, with a bit of common sense, you can manage all of the drug interaction related issues. So last few words. Obviously, we're in a world of single tablets and people are very interested in the lack of intrusiveness that single tablets have into treatment. None of the single tablets, I would say, is a perfect product. Each carries a burden from either their background regimen or the third agent that's included, or both. So that's why we need individualized treatment, because each product is not for everyone, but each product is for somebody along the lines. What we have to remember when we're switching people around is that we want to make sure that there's a sufficient genetic barrier in our combination. So again, when we're switching to single tablets, we need to think, is this appropriate in terms of this person's past treatment history? Because, of course, when they didn't pay any attention to past treatment history in the switch mark study, and you lowered a genetic barrier with moving from away from a PI, you saw an excess of failure in the treatment regimen. And, of course, one of the phenomenons that, you know, Cal talked about this in this presentation from Glasgow last year, was that if you take a single tablet, you don't have this phenomenon of selective non-adherence. So what people often say is, the ritonavir gives me diarrhea, so I'll miss that because I'm going out on public transport today, and so they selectively miss it. Or I've got 31 days in this pack and 28 days in that pack, and so I run out of product A before I run out of product B, and therefore I'll just refill when I've got all my tablets. And when you've got a single tablet, you can only either miss it or take it. Whereas if you've got other products in your combination, you have the potential for partial adherence to those products. So then at CROI, there was a couple of presentations of switch studies. This was from a PI to Stribild, showing that effectively everyone, people who hadn't failed treatment previously, switching over, maintained virological efficacy, and more of them discontinued from the PI than from Stribild after switching. Remembering this was an open label study, and people may have discontinued if they were randomized to a group that they didn't want to be randomized to. And in patient reported outcomes, people often said, actually, I've got some gastrointestinal effects from my PI at baseline, and these actually resolved with switching. Bloating, they specifically tried to pick on, even though you can't grade it, and there was some small but statistically significant decline in the amount of bloating observed. And with the non-nucleoside switch, the same phenomenon, very few virological failures in either arm, treatment discontinuation was more common in the non-nucleoside group. And in terms of patient satisfaction, the dreaming phenomenon went away, sleep improved, anxiety levels and dizziness levels improved, underlining that people often felt well on a medication that they were doing well on, because you had to be on your background, on your randomized treatment for at least 6 months before entering the study, often still had a resolution of symptoms that they weren't particularly complaining about at the time that they entered the study. You remove a product and people suddenly realize they were having a problem. So I like to go through that kind of list of things when I'm selecting treatment for an individual, saying what are the regimens that have been most well proven, particularly in the more difficult to treat people, particularly in special circumstances that the individual in front of me may have, and then think about the safety profiles of those products around lipids, around gastrointestinal side effects, around the things that drive people to discontinue treatment or niggle away at their adherence over time, and then think that if the product is right and available as a single tablet, then I'm going to use that as my preferred choice for my patients. So I will stop there and be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.